One property we look for when gauging the scalability of a blockchain system is its ability to deal with an increased transaction volume. To be scalable, a blockchain should be able to function with a higher transaction velocity. So we're looking for a higher TPS, or transactions per second. The definition here is pretty self-explanatory in its name. Being able to handle a greater volume of transactions per second means that our blockchain system would be able to handle more transactions with a higher velocity. Another property we're looking for is the speed with which we can update our distributed ledger. And in the case of blockchain, we call this the block time, the average time it takes for a new block or update to be appended to the blockchain. And as with enabling a higher volume of transactions, the reason for wanting faster block times is pretty easy to see as well. If I'm buying a coffee with Bitcoin, there's no guarantee that my transaction will go through, especially with so many other transactions flowing around with potentially higher transaction fees. You may know that the average block time in Bitcoin is roughly 10 minutes long, and generally when making a transaction, we would want to wait 6 confirmations to be confident, with high probability, that our transaction has gone through and has been finalized. This isn't scalable though, at least in the sense that I don't want to be waiting for an hour every morning I want to get coffee. And one side note, as we know, blockchain is a decentralized system. As such, especially with large public networks, we want to lower the barrier of entry if possible. We're aiming for decentralization, and a flat network topology is preferred, one where anyone who wants to join can join. One way we can do this is pay particularly close attention to the size of the blockchain. Historically, if there's a high storage requirement for users to join the network, then users might be disincentivized to join the network completely. Perhaps because they don't have much storage space, or perhaps because they can't justify using so much of their precious storage space for a blockchain, which has no immediate value to them. For example, in Bitcoin, many users don't want to run full nodes since as of late August 2018, the blockchain is roughly 180 gigabytes. Users can't simply run a full node on their phone, and most users won't want to run a full node on their laptops or personal computers either, due to the blockchain's immense size. And it's become that size in only a couple of years. What happens if the blockchain's around for another couple decades, or even centuries? If the blockchain continues to grow at the same rate it's been growing at, then it can very easily become very large and unmanageable in the future. So, in order to make it easier for nodes to join the network in the future, whether they be run by dedicated or casual users, we must design blockchain systems keeping into account storage size. Fundamentally, there's a scalability trilemma here. This was proposed by Ethereum Research and claims that in any blockchain system, we can only have 2 of 3 properties shown here: decentralization, security, and scalability. We formalize the notion of decentralization by the amounts of resources everyone has, on average, in the network. So decentralization, in the case of the trilemma, is the system being able to run in a scenario where each participant in the network has access to, on average, the same amount of resources. Scalability is defined by a system's ability to process some increasing large volume of transactions at increasing speeds. So given everyone in the network has on average the same amount of resources, how fast can we make the system? Security is defined as a system's ability to withstand attackers with up to a certain amount of resources. Particularly, they could have resources on the order of the total number of resources in the network. That's a lot of formalisms, but it's easy to see that trade-offs are inherent in these types of systems. For example, if you increase the number of participants in the network, then the more we have to consider how including more transactions in a block or speeding up the block confirmation time might cause security to suffer. Or if we want to make a system have much faster block times without adjustment anywhere else, we could suffer in security since faster blocks means more orphan blocks. And perhaps if someone has the right amount of resources, they could tilt the system in their favor, and so decentralization would take a hit. To understand all of that more, let's look at further detail and do a bit of math. In the graph on the screen, we have the size of Bitcoin transactions over time. The graph is a bit outdated, but the scalability concerns still apply. We can see that on average, Bitcoin transactions have a size of around 546 bytes. And here we have a similar graph, but of Bitcoin block size. The system was designed for 1 megabyte blocks, and we can see that reflected in the graph. So here's a quick calculation based on the numbers we've collected so far. From the previous slides, we have an average of about 546 bytes per transaction. The current block size is 1 megabyte, and the block time in Bitcoin is 10 minutes on average. Therefore, we can compute the sustained maximum transaction volume in transactions per second. By simple dimensional analysis, we have 1 megabyte per block times one transaction per 546 bytes times one block every 10 minutes, and we get a final value of 3.2 transactions per second. That's not too hot. Compared with some other traditional payment systems, Bitcoin is way behind in terms of speed. Bitcoin has, on average, about 3 transactions per second, and we just calculated in the previous slide that has a max of 3.2 transactions per second. On the other hand, PayPal has an average of 150 transactions per second, with a maximum load of 450 transactions per second. And even more is Visa, which has an average transaction rate of around 2,000 transactions per second, and has a theoretical high load of 56,000 transactions per second. Comparing that with Bitcoin's 3.2 transactions per second, the difference is definitely quite drastic. So that's the situation at hand. Suppose we now want to make our transaction rate comparable to that of Visa, so we can finally realize our dream of using Bitcoin to buy coffee and not wait an hour for the transaction to be finalized. To increase our transactions per second, we have two fundamental options. Looking at the fraction transactions over seconds, it's very easy to see that in order to increase TPS, we could increase the transaction volume or decrease the block time. And that's just because TPS is directly proportional to the transaction volume we have and inversely proportional to that of the block time. To increase the volume of transactions, we can do this a number of ways. We could either decrease the size of transactions and thus be able to fit more transactions into each block given an unchanged block time, and alternatively, we could also increase the size of blocks so that each block could hold more transactions, and thus at each block time, we'd have more transactions. And on the other hand, to decrease the block time, there's not much else to say. We increase the rate at which we create blocks. There are definitely drawbacks and considerations for each of these approaches, so that's what we're going to be looking at in the later sections. In terms of different techniques with which we can scale, there are two fundamental options. Setting aside blockchain scalability for now and just looking at the big picture of how we can scale systems in general, we can see that we can either scale vertically or horizontally. Vertical scaling, or scaling up, implies adding more resources so that each machine can do more work. Traditionally, this is done by adding more memory, compute, or storage to a particular machine. Horizontal scaling, or scaling out, implies adding more machines of the same capability, and to add more distributed functionality. For example, imagine adding more machines to your compute cluster if we're talking about cloud. And combining ideas from both vertical and horizontal scaling simultaneously is diagonal scaling. Applying this intuition to blockchain, we can categorize scaling efforts. For vertical scaling, there have been efforts to increase the block size or decrease the block time. There have also been alternative fork resolution policies to Bitcoin's longest chain wins policy. For example, we have the GHOST, or Greedy Heaviest Observed Subtree protocol. And also, there's the idea of setting up payment channels between particular participants in the network. For horizontal scaling, there have also been many projects focusing on sharding, a method of distributing a database, and also on sidechains, as opposed to keeping everything on a singular blockchain. And finally, for diagonal scaling, we've seen projects like Plasma and Cosmos, which aim not only to make individual blockchains more efficient, but also to create new value and connect these blockchains together. Besides the traditional standpoint of scaling up and out, there's another useful model to view scaling solutions, which is layers. Yep, that's right. Blockchains have layers. We'll cover this part pretty quickly, since it's pretty insightful to see examples of these solutions, but here's a quick rundown. Layer 1 scaling solutions refer to those that change the blockchain and its protocol itself. This could be by modifying parameters of the blockchain, like block size, block speed, and the hash puzzle, and changing a blockchain's consensus mechanism. And these would all be layer 1 scaling solutions. For example, if you remember from week 1, you might be able to recognize that Casper the Friendly Ghost, correct by construction, is a layer 1 scaling solution, since it would fundamentally change the infrastructure and operation of the Ethereum blockchain. On the other hand, we have layer 2 scaling solutions, which push expensive computation off the blockchain. This is also called off-chain scaling. Generally, layer 2 solutions are easier to execute since they don't require a complete overwrite of the underlying blockchain like in layer 1 solutions. For example, also from week 1 is Casper the Friendly Finality Gadget, the proof-of-stake overlay on top of proof-of-work. And that's a layer 2 scaling solution, since it's implemented simply as a smart contract on top of the existing Ethereum infrastructure. We'll go into other examples of layer 2 scaling, some of which include sidechains and payment channels. Going forward, we choose to organize blockchain scaling solutions as vertical and horizontal, as well as layer 1 and layer 2, so knowing the distinctions are important in identifying solutions.